Welcome to the fifth episode of our web series, VKC, The Power of 30. We at Vinod Kothari and Company are happy to present this web series of 30 episodes covering various topics relevant for corporate professionals across the country. We have already given a brief overview about non-banking financial companies in our third episode. Moving ahead, in the second part, we shall be providing an insight on some crucial aspects of regulatory framework for NBFCs. Before we proceed, let us just revise our understanding quickly. What is an NBFC? NBFC is a non-banking company carrying on the business of financial institution. It is important to note that any other form of entity other than a company incorporated under the Companies Act is not an NBFC. In case the company satisfies the principality test or the 50-50 criteria, application for registration is to be filed with RBI. Section 45IA of the RBI Act 1934 provides that no non-banking financial company shall commence or carry on the business of a non-banking financial institution without obtaining a certificate of registration from the bank. So it is important for the NBFC to be a company under the Companies Act and to have a minimum net owned fund of rupees 2 crores. The NBFC classification has already been discussed at length earlier. Just to give a quick recap, NBFCs can be broadly classified in terms of its ability to accept deposit into deposit-taking NBFCs and non-deposit-taking NBFC. Further, based on the asset size, the non-deposit-taking NBFCs are classified into systemically important NBFCs, those with asset size of rupees 500 crore or above, and non-systemically important NBFCs with asset size of less than rupees 500 crores. Over here, it is important to know that there is a concept of multiple NBFCs which requires that the total assets of all NBFCs in a group must be aggregated to determine the limit. Further, based on the kind of activity that the NBFC is conducting, that is investment, lending or financial activity, the classification can be done as mentioned in this slide. As we noted in our earlier video, mostly the NBFCs are registered with the RBI. However, there are certain categories of NBFCs which are regulated by other sectoral regulators such as SEBI, NHB, etc. In this video, we'll restrict ourselves to the regulatory framework laid down by RBI only. We all know Reserve Bank is the apex institution in our country and has been given the power under the RBI Act to regulate the banking and payment system of our country. With the insertion of Chapter 3B, RBI was given the power under the Act to register, lay down policy, issue directions, regulate and exercise surveillance over non-banking institutions and financial institutions. Earlier, RBI would issue master circulars on 1st July every year, consolidating all the regulatory amendments for the ease of reference. It was a single point reference and was valid for 1 year. Usually, the master circulars were mere consolidation of all RBI notifications and circulars issued since the last master circular. From 2016 onwards, master directions are being issued. The master direction supersedes the master circular. RBI has issued one master direction for each subject matter covering all instructions on that subject. Any changes in the rules, regulation or policy are communicated during the year by way of notification, and subsequently the master directions available on the RBI website are amended along with the date on which such changes made. With the master directions in one place, we now do not have to navigate from one circular to another to understand the various regulations applicable on an NBFC. In order to understand the regulations, we will not have to look beyond these new directions. Like we can see, there is a master direction for deposit taking NBFCs, and there is a specific master direction for non-deposit taking systemically important NBFC. Now this master direction, this particular master direction non-banking financial company, systemically important non-deposit taking company and deposit taking has to be applied by both deposit taking as well as non-deposit taking and systemically important NBFCs. Further, there is also a master direction specifically for non-deposit taking and non-systemically important NBFCs. There is also a separate set of regulations, master direction for core investment companies that are systemically important. Over here, by systemically important, I mean that the asset size is more than 100 crore and they are having access to public funds. These are regulated by the master direction applicable on CIC. These four are the principal directions regulating the four categories of NBFCs. Apart from this, there are several other master directions as well issued by the RBI, some of which are mentioned over here, like the master direction for monitoring of frauds, which is applicable for deposit accepting and non-deposit and systemically important NBFCs. The IT framework, which was introduced last year itself, is applicable on all categories of NBFCs. Then come the returns, the master direction for returns, and the master direction for company auditor's report. That is also applicable for all the categories of NBFCs mentioned herein. Now let us understand some of the key regulation laid down in this master circular, master directions mentioned over here. We'll start with the master direction applicable for NBFC ND-NSI, that is having asset size of less than 500 crore and not accepting deposit. The main contents of the master directions are mentioned here, starting from the definition of important terms to prudential norms, the regulations dealt in chapter 4, to the fair practice code dealt in chapter 5, acquisition and transfer of control requiring prior approval, the miscellaneous provisions and reporting requirement. All of these are covered under one particular master direction. This is the master direction for ND-NSI. Now we can determine the applicability of the provisions of this master direction based on the fact that whether the NBFC is accepting public funds and is having customer interface or not. So if the NBFC is having both customer interface and access to public funds, the entire directions is applicable on that NBFC. If the NBFC is neither having customer interface nor access to public funds, it is exempted from the provisions of the prudential norms dealt in chapter 4, the FPC norms, that is fair practice code dealt in chapter 5, and the KYC directions, that is also issued for commercial banks and is a separate master direction that has to be complied and is mentioned in para 68 of this master direction. Again, now NBFCs which are not having customer interface but are having access to public funds will be exempted from the fair practice code and KYC norms. So usually the KYC and fair practice is only applicable in case you have customer interface. Next, if we have customer interface but we do not have access to public funds, then the prudential regulations are not applicable on that particular NBFC. Let us now delve into some of the relevant provisions of the master direction. One of the significant provision is the leverage requirement for non-systemically important NBFC. This is not applicable for NBFCs, MFIs and NBFC IFCs. By leverage, we understand that how much can the NBFC leverage its own funds to procure outside liabilities. As prescribed by RBI, the ratio between the outside liability and own fund shall not be more than 7 times. For example, if 10 crores is put in as own funds, then only 70 crores can be bring out as outside liabilities. Now, as per the definition provided under the regulation, outside liability means the total liabilities that is appearing on the liability side of the balance sheet. This excludes, however, the paid up capital, reserves and surplus and instruments which are compulsorily convertible within a period of 5 years. So if I have CCDs which are compulsorily convertible into equity, CCDs are compulsorily convertible, are debentures but are compulsorily convertible. So if the maturity is within a period of 5 years, they will be excluded from the definition of outside liability, otherwise they will be included. So this includes all kind of debt, even if there are hybrid instruments like OCD and all will be included in the category of outside liabilities. Even if there are guarantees that have been issued and are not appearing on the balance sheet, they are also considered a part of outside liability. Here it is important to note one more thing, that operational creditors, though it is not my borrowing, but for my day-to-day affairs, I'm having creditors on my balance sheet, those are also a part of my outside liabilities. Next, moving to the definition of own funds, there are 5 important things that we need to add up. First is the paid up equity capital, preference shares which are compulsorily convertible into equity, third is the free reserves, fourth, balance in the share premium account, and fifth is the cap reserves, which represents any surplus that is out of sale proceeds of asset. We are not considering the reserves created by revaluation of asset over here. And then the additions of these 5 items have to be reduced by 3 items, that is accumulated loss balance, book value of intangible assets, and deferred revenue expenditure, if any. So leverage ratio, maintaining the leverage ratio is one of the crucial capital requirements for non-systemically important NBFCs. Next, moving on to the prudential norms, it can be divided into three aspects. The main are the asset classification, income recognition, and the provisioning requirement. So every NBFC has, except MFIs, have to classify its lease and hire purchase assets or the loan and advances and any other form of credit into standard asset, substandard asset, doubtful asset, and loss asset. Now, looking into each one of these, standard asset, as the name suggests, is an asset in respect of which no default in either the payment of principal, repayment of principal, or payment of interest has been perceived. And there is no sign of any risk attached to it other than the normal risk to the business. In case of substandard, doubtful, and loss, we'll first have to understand what is a NPA, so non-performing asset. Non-performing assets are assets in respect of which the interest or the installment has remained overdue for a period of more than 6 months, 6 months or more. So that becomes a NPA. Now, an NPA, if it remains as a NPA for a period not exceeding 18 months, then that has to be classified as a substandard asset. And a substandard asset, if it remains as a substandard asset for a period exceeding 18 months, then it is classified as a doubtful asset. So once an asset is classified as a NPA and it remains as such for so for 3 months, the installment has been for 6 months, the installment was has not been paid and it is remaining overdue. So it becomes as a NPA in my books. Then I have to wait for 18 months to classify it as a substandard asset. After once it is classified as a NPA and it remains as such for 18 months as a NPA, then it is classified as a substandard. And then a substandard asset, if it remains as a substandard in my books for a period of 18 months, it is classified as a doubtful asset. A loss asset is an asset which is identified as loss by the NBFC or its internal external auditor, or the RBI during its inspection says it so, to the extent it has not been written off by the NBFC. So that particular asset is my loss asset. After doing this classification, what is required is the provisioning. So NBFCs, after taking into account the time lag between an account becoming non-performing, its recognition as such, the realization of the security and erosion over time in value of the security charge, they have to make provision against substandard, doubtful, and loss assets as well as the standard asset. For standard asset, the provisioning requirement is 0.25%. In case of substandard, it is 10%. In case of doubtful, it depends upon whether it is secured or unsecured. The unsecured portion has to be provided for up to 100%. For the secured portion, it depends upon the period for which the asset has been considered as doubtful. And if it is up to 1 year, it is 20% provisioning. If it is up to 1 to 3 years, it is 30%. And more than 3 years is 50%. The third and last important aspect of provisioning norms is the income recognition. Income has to be recognized based on recognized accounting principles. Accordingly, for standard asset, income is usually recognized based on accrual basis, whereas for non-performing asset, it is on recovery or cash basis. And in case any income has been recognized before the asset became NPA and it is remaining unrealized, it has to be reversed. So this chapter 4 of the master direction deals with provisioning norms. There are several other norms as well. Like for hire purchase, the provisioning is different and all. Moving on to chapter 5, that deals with the fair practice code. Now, NBFCs that are having customer interface, that is, they are dealing with borrowers, have to be fair in their conduct while doing lending business. The directions lays down general principles on adequate disclosures on the terms of loan and also on the recovery methods used by the NBFCs. So fair lending practices have to apply across all aspects of operation, including marketing, loan origination, processing, servicing, and collection activities. As per the fair practice code, the loan application form must disclose necessary information which affects the interest of the borrower, so that there is a meaningful comparison with the terms and conditions offered by other NBFCs. And the NBFCs must also devise a system of giving acknowledgement for receipt of all loan application. Preferably, the time frame within which the loan application will be disposed of should also be indicated in the acknowledgement. Also, in case of recovery of loan, the NBFC should not resort to undue harassment and persistently bothering the borrowers at odd hours, using muscle power for recovery of loan, etc. So these are certain things that has to be kept in mind. Also, apart from the FPC, there is a requirement of having grievance redressal mechanism that has to be adopted by the board of directors, and it must be along with the FPC be mentioned at all places of business and on the website of the company as well. In case the NBFC is financing vehicles, so for that repossession of vehicles, the clauses must be built in the contract or the agreement, such as the notice period before taking possession, circumstances wherein the notice period can be waived, the procedure for giving repossession, and such other clauses must be specifically provided over there in the loan agreement. Though interest rates are not regulated by RBI, but rates of interest beyond a certain level may be seen to be excessive and can neither be sustainable nor be conforming to normal finance practice, and hence it is advisable that the NBFC's the interest rate policy must be adopted by the NBFC so that they set down the principles of determining interest rate on loan. Now, apart from the specific directions for NBFC factors, MFI, IDFs that are covered in the directions, there are certain other requirements as well, such as the policy on demand and call loan, which is applicable for such NBFCs who are extending such loans. They have to frame a policy. Similarly, for lending against gold, there is a separate set of directions governing gold lending. Lending against security of shares, so NBFC with asset size of 100 crores and above, they have to maintain a LTV of 50%. There's also norms for restructuring of advances, which is on the similar lines as specified by RBI for commercial banks and is mentioned in the directions itself. Now, in certain cases, when with respect to the change of address of the NBFC, the directors or auditors, apart from for which the prior approval is required in case of directors, the company has to inform the RBI following within a month of, say, 1 month from the date of the occurrence of such change. Moving on to another important regulation prescribed by the IRBI is with respect to acquisition or transfer of control, whereby NBFCs are required to obtain a prior written consent from RBI by way of a full-fledged application to RBI. So the three circumstances are: one, for takeover or acquisition of control by an NBFC, which may or may not result in the change of management, but there is a takeover or acquisition of control. Next is if there is a change in the shareholding of the NBFC, if there is any acquisition or transfer wherein the shareholding of 26% or more of the paid up equity capital, so the word over here is paid up equity capital, is if there is any acquisition that is resulting in such change, that has to be obtained by way the approval from RBI, a prior approval from RBI has to be obtained. In case of change in the management of the NBFC that results in change in more than 30% of the directors, this does not include independent directors. In that case also, prior approval from RBI is required. In certain cases, prior public notice is also required. That is also for at least 30 days public notice. That is in case there is a change in control or ownership, and it has to be given in at least one leading national and one leading local regional language newspaper. So now let us discuss all these three instances of taking prior approval separately. First is takeover or acquisition of control. Over here, the meaning of control has to be taken from the SEBI SAS regulation, which means right exercisable directly or indirectly to appoint majority of directors or to control management or policy decision individually or along with PAC. So just to summarize, any indirect or direct change in the company by way of maybe say shareholding, management rights or agreements or in any other manner which results in giving the power to appoint majority of director or to control the management or policy decisions, this can be individually or along with your PAC person acting in concert, then that tantamounts to be a takeover or acquisition of control. And for this change in control, the prior approval from RBI is required. Over here, let us also understand the term PAC, which is also defined in SEBI SAS Regulations 2011. PAC is a person with a common object of acquisition of or control. It includes company, its holding and subsidiary, company under the same management or control, the company, its directors and any person entrusted with the management of the company. There is also a concept of deemed PACs, which has been defined over there. Next, the second instance for getting prior approval from RBI is in case there is a change in shareholding of the NBFC, including progressive increase over time. which would result in change in shareholding of 26% or more of the paid up equity capital. Here, transfer of preference shares will not have any impact, and also buyback or reduction of capital is excluded from this. Now over here, any progressive increase in shareholding which would result in change would require prior approval. Here the term progressive increase implies that while looking at the quantum of shareholding, we will have to consider the aggregate of shareholding acquired by a person. So let's say if I acquire 10% paid up equity capital in the first instance and subsequently 16% is acquired. In the first case, there is no requirement of taking prior approval since I'm not crossing the threshold. However, in the second case, even though I'm just acquiring 16%, but in aggregate, the shareholding has reached the threshold. Hence, a prior approval of RBI would be required for acquisition of 16% of paid up equity capital. In cases of intra-group transfers, the formalities have been reduced, and as per the FAQs issued by RBI, the NBFC will have to submit an application on the letterhead for obtaining the prior approval, and based on the application, on a case-to-case basis, the RBI would decide whether the NBFC is required to submit further documents as prescribed therein or not for processing the application. Now, the third instance of getting prior approval from RBI is in case the management, there is a change in the management resulting in more than 30% of the composition of board of directors. Here, where I am computing 30%, I don't have to include independent directors, they are excluded. And in this circumstances, if I am having a board of three directors and any one of them is being removed, whether it is by retirement or rotation or any such other case, then prior approval must be obtained. But then there is also a question, what happens in case of death of a director? So it is not possible to predict such an event, and hence we cannot apply for prior approval. In such cases, it is advisable that an intimation must be given within reasonable period of time to the RBI. So though there might be instances wherein it might happen for reasons beyond the control of the promoters that such changes are taking place, but in all cases, the prior approval of RBI has to be obtained unless otherwise exempted. And so these were some of the main provisions of the master directions for NSI, NTNSI. Now moving ahead to the master directions for NBFC, NTSI, that is systemically important, having asset size of 500 or above. The main contents of the master direction, it is similar to that as we have already discussed. There are certain difference that is over there, certain additional requirement and a few differences that can be seen. The capital requirement over there was leverage. Over here we have a concept of CRAR that we'll discuss just now. And next, the prudential regulations, almost it remains the same, but the timelines are different. The fair practice code is the same. The acquisition transfer of control is the same. Corporate governance and the concentration norms is an addition in case of systemically important NBFCs that we'll discuss. So first, let us discuss the asset classification, income recognition and provisioning norm. This sums up our prudential norms and is the same as was explained in case of non-systemically important NBFCs. But over here, what is different is the timeline. For the standard asset, it remains the same, that there is no default. In case of NPA, the timeline instead of 6 months become 3 months. So the overdue has to be for 3 months. And then that overdue has to the asset must be classified as a NPA for at least a period of 12 months to be classified as a substandard, and that substandard status must stay for 12 months to become a doubtful asset. And loss asset is the same if it has been classified by the NBFC, its auditor or the RBI during inspection, and it has not been written off by the NBFC to the extent it has not been written off. The provisioning requirement again, for standard asset, for NSI it was 0.25%, but for systemically important it is 0.4%. For substandard and doubtful, the provisioning is the same as discussed. The income recognition principles also remains the same, and it is on accrual basis for standard asset, but on cash or recovery basis for non-performing assets, that is substandard, doubtful and loss. Now the capital requirement in case of NSIs was the leverage ratio. Over here, the CRAR, capital risk adequacy ratio. So we have to maintain a capital ratio consisting of tier 1 and tier 2 capital which shall not be less than 15% of its aggregate risk-weighted assets on balance sheet and risk-adjusted value of off-balance sheet items. First, let us discuss what is aggregate risk-weighted assets. So, in the direction, the degree of credit risk has been expressed as percentage weights that has been assigned to the balance sheet assets. Those have to be multiplied by these percentage weights to arrive at the risk-adjusted value of asset. In case of off-balance sheet items also, the credit conversion factor has been prescribed. So, the off-balance sheet, the notional amount of that off-balance sheet transaction has to be converted into a credit equivalent amount. They have to be multiplied by the specified credit conversion factor. And then the resulting credit equivalent amount has to be multiplied with the risk weight applicable. Accordingly, we shall get the aggregate risk-weighted assets. So, that will be the risk-weighted assets of our on the balance sheet and off the balance sheet of the NBFC. Now, coming to the numerator, Tier 1 and Tier 2 capital, it is important to know what is the definition of Tier 1 and Tier 2 capital. So, Tier 1 capital consists of own fund. Own fund we have already discussed while we were discussing about the leverage ratios, which consists of five important things, that is the paid up capital, preference shares, compulsorily convertible, free reserves, balance in general reserves and balance in share premium account and the cap reserve. This own fund has to be deduced by investments if any has been done in the shares of other NBFCs or investments in my subsidiary or companies in the same group. So that has to be reduced to the extent in aggregate 10% of own funds. So any investment in the subsidiary or group company, if it is done exceeding 10% of my own fund, that has to be reduced to get the amount of Tier 1 capital. And perpetual debt instruments also to the extent it does not exceed 15% of my Tier 1 capital is included in this calculation. Next, moving ahead to the definition of Tier 2 capital, this includes six main things, that is the preference shares that are compulsorily convertible into equity, revaluation reserves at discounted rate of 55%, general provisions, hybrid debt capital instruments, subordinated debt, perpetual debt instruments that were not taken as a part of Tier 1 capital are to the extent. So now Tier 2 capital cannot be more than Tier 1 capital. So after calculating Tier 1 and Tier 2, we have to add it and then we have to calculate our CRAR by dividing it with the aggregate risk weighted asset. So as you can just see that over here in own funds, while in Tier 1 capital, we had included preference shares that were compulsorily convertible into equity. In Tier 2, we are including those which are not, other than those which are compulsorily convertible. Also the provisions, the free reserves were already taken in as a part of own funds. So the general provisions that are for standard asset and all are included as a part of Tier 2 capital. Hybrid debt capital instruments are those which have the features of both debt as well as equity, and subordinated debt is and perpetual debt instrument has also been defined in the directions. Coming to the concentration norms, so why is there a requirement of having concentration norm is that in case the whole of the NBFC asset, that is to say maybe the loans, is concentrated to only one entity, what would happen if there is no proper diversification, and if the entity to which the funds have been concentrated fails, then the NBFC also fails despite the market being good. So thus, to prevent such a situation, the concentration norms have been brought in. It has restriction with respect to lending and investment. This is not applicable in case of NBFC MFIs with asset size of 500 crores and above. So the restriction is as that the NBFCs cannot lend to any single borrower or to a group of borrower exceeding 15% and 25% of its own fund respectively. In case of investments, that cannot be done in another company exceeding 15% of own fund and to a single group of companies exceeding 25% of own funds. And if I'm seeing on aggregate the lending and investment taken together, it should not exceed 25% in case of a single party and 40% in case of a single group of parties. Systemically important, as the word itself suggests, and looking at the size that they have, asset of more than 500 crores, it is important that the corporate governance norms that comes from the Companies Act should also be applicable on these entities. So the understanding is that the NBFC has specifically included these requirements in the directions. So the total requirements are mentioned over here, starting from the formation of committees, namely the audit committee, nomination, asset liability management committee, risk management committee. The audit and nomination is the same as we have for other companies on whom the applicability comes from the Companies Act. The asset liability management committee, the requirement here comes because the asset liability risk is something that the NBFC is itself funded by banks and other financial institution, and it is supposed to fund itself also from those funds. So there must not be a mismatch between the assets and the liabilities. So just to keep the credit risk of counterparties and just to eliminate those risks and to manage those risks, this committee has to be formed. And the risk management committee also sees that the risks that are applicable on the NBFCs are identified and tackled in a way by laying down policies and framework for the NBFC. Next, coming on to the requirement of having a policy for ascertaining the fit and proper criteria. So we all know that directors are of the company are responsible for looking after its day-to-day management and operations. So to exercise their responsibility in a diligent manner, it is essential that we ascertain and ensure that the person who is proposed to be appointed on the board is suitable for the post, based on their qualification, technical expertise, track record, etc. So it is imperative that the company lays down specific criteria that must be fulfilled by the director to be appointed, and before its appointment, and also during his tenure as a director. And hence comes the role of this fit and proper criteria, which has to be laid down by the board of directors, and at the time of appointment and on a continuing basis, we have to ascertain whether the directors are complying with the same or not. Additionally, as required under the directions, the NBFC must also ensure that they take a declaration and an undertaking along with a deed of covenant from the directors on every appointment and reappointment. There's also a requirement of quarterly submission of statement of any change in directors and a certificate from the managing director that confirming that the compliance of fit and proper criteria has been done. This has to be submitted by the 15th of by the end of every quarter, and the last quarter certificate is to be certified by the statutory auditor also. The board is also required to at regular intervals see that the it has to be put up on the towards the board that the progress made in putting in place a progressive risk management system, the risk management policy strategy to be followed by the NBFC, and whether the there is conformity with the corporate governance standards, that is the composition of various committee, their role, function, periodicity of meeting, compliance. And all these have to be regularly checked by the board of directors. Then there is also disclosure requirements in the annual financial statements that has to be complied with. And the last requirement for the corporate governance is framing of an internal guidelines on corporate governance. Apart from this, the rotation of directors, statutory auditor and audit firm is also there, mentioned over there in the directions. So these were the main, some of the crucial aspects of the master directions applicable for systemically important and non-systemically important NBFCs. Apart from this, based on the activity that the NBFC is conducting, like IDFs, MFIs and NBFC factors, the specific directions are also mentioned in the directions based on the asset size of the respective NBFC. We shall now also quickly try to cover the key provisions of the master direction applicable on CICs being core investment companies. So the master direction is applicable only if the asset size is more than 100 crores, either individually or with other group CICs, and it has access to public deposit. It raises or holds public deposit. In that case, it is a systemically important CIC and has to abide by the regulations laid therein. Over here, the definition of companies in the group is important to note. So the definition is laid down, which includes the subsidiary parent, joint venture associate, promoter promotee, related party sharing a common brand name or having investment in equity shares of 20% and above. All these will tantamount to be classified as companies. If you are having any such relationship, it will be you'll be falling under the same group and you'll be classified as companies in the group. So as we all know, the CICs are basically set up for investment in the equity shares of the group companies mostly. So it is important to know this definition of companies in the group. Now coming to the capital requirement, over here it's not the leverage or CRAR, but it is the adjusted net worth, which should not be less than 30% of its aggregate risk weighted assets. The aggregate risk weighted assets we have already discussed on balance sheet and off balance sheet. And adjusted net worth is over here. If we look at the definition of adjusted net worth, it is the aggregate of own funds as appearing in the last balance sheet, and it has to be increased by 50% of the unrealized appreciation in the book value of the quoted investment as on the date of the last balance sheet. And also if there is an increase in the equity share capital since the date of the last balance sheet. Also the reduction has to be done if there is any amount of diminution in the aggregate book value of quoted investment, or there is any reduction in the equity share capital since the date of the last balance sheet. So then we get the adjusted net worth. The leverage requirement also has been laid down for CICs, that is the outside liability shall not exceed 2.5 times the adjusted net worth. The outside liabilities and has already been discussed for non-systemically important NBFCs, and the adjusted net worth is provided over here. There are several other requirements, the prudential norms and all are mentioned over there in the master directions itself. Now, one of the most crucial part in case of operating an NBFC is the returns and certification that we are required to do. So now that we have the master directions of returns in one place, so it all these returns and the submission certifications have been laid down over there for all the NBFCs. Over here, we have just provided a list of the returns of the for systemically important deposit taking NBFCs. These are the returns that have to be filed and the periodicity within which, because some of the returns like NBS 1, 2, 3 have to be filed on a quarterly basis. ALM is a half yearly filing that has to be done. Branch info is again quarterly. Statutory auditor certificate in all the cases is annual certification that has to be done. And CRILC and SMA 2 reporting is applicable in certain circumstances. Next also comes the requirement for reporting for systemically important non-deposit taking NBFCs, that is NBS 7, that is filed on a quarterly basis. NBS 7 is basically on prudential norms, so to capture whether we have complied with the various prudential norm, capital adequacy, asset classification, provisioning, NOF, etc. Then there's NBFC NDSI 500 crore, which has to be filed on a quarterly basis. This is also on important financial parameters, that is the component of asset and liability, profit and loss account, exposure on sensitive sectors. These are to be reported over there. ALM 1, ALM 2, ALM 3. ALM 1 is quarterly and 2 and 3 are on a half yearly basis. These are also to show the asset liability management of the company and our returns on the short term dynamic liquidity and the structural liquidity, interest rate sensitivity of the NBFC. The branch info return and CRILC and SMA 2 reporting is also done if required, and the statutory auditor certificate, which is an annual compliance to be followed. In case of small NBFCs, that is the asset size between 100 to 500 crore, it is only the annual compliance of NBS 9 and the statutory auditor certificate. And in case the NBFC with asset size less than 100 crore, it is NBS 8 and the statutory auditor certificate that has to be filed. The NBS 8 and 9 are basically the financial indicators by the NBFCs. So they capture the profile information, financial details,